monthly CDs. Starting back last January, if I'm not mistaken. The Lord began to deal with me in a just in a real increase of Himself. And in just searching the scripture, and the whole thing was sparked by this little pamphlet here that I get from the Golden Candlestick people, who are friends of mine in the Netherlands, actually, in the Netherlands. They print tapes of Brother Sparks, so they're T. Austin Sparks. Many of these are done or spoken years and years and years ago. And always, when they send me a group of them, and I put them there in our library, but I always take one out and I sit down and read it. And this one really, really hit me. It's entitled Jesus, Prophet, Priest, and King. And that didn't mean a lot to me. But I started reading it, and it's not very long. And I got into Deuteronomy with it. Brother Sparks always puts me in the scripture. He always does, he always has. And I've been reading his writings. Well, I doubt that he ever wrote anything, but I've been reading transcriptions of his teachings since 1964. And I've never met him. I have met Brother Fromke, DeVern Fromke, and been in. He and I have spoken some Bible conferences together. And he was a protege of Brother Sparks, and a good friend of Brother Sparks, and had Brother Sparks to come and speak for him and the groups that he'd had there in Indiana. But he's always put me in the Word, in the Scripture, with regard to seeing Jesus. And so I read that, and then I put it away, and then I began to search the Scripture. And there wasn't that much said. He just mentioned a few things, some of which I'll probably read. It wasn't that much said, but it caught my attention. And the Lord began to deal with me about it. And I had never comprehended Christ in that way. Never. And it answered so many questions that I had, that I had just stored away, because that's what I do with most of mine. I just store them. Because, you know, I know if they're legitimate, then a realization will come in the seeing of Christ as I grow, as I see Him. And if they're not legitimate, then they don't need to be answered anyway, so I just kind of put them aside. But it answered so many of those questions, and every time I come to what I call a new view of Christ, not a view of a new Christ, but a new view of the Lord Jesus, an expanded view of Him, an ongoing view of Him, it does gather up questions I've had about certain scriptures, questions I've had about certain stories in the Bible. And I know that they're a type and shadow of something. And I know what's been made out of them, but I know it can't be that, because it's got to be a testimony of Jesus Christ somewhere there. And to me, it just hadn't been life yet. But it's there. It's in the testimony. And with every view of Christ, some of that comes alive. I mean, it just comes alive, and there it is. And you actually see the real interpretation of that scripture. You actually see the real testimony of that scripture. You see what Jesus said, these are they that testify of me. And they come alive, not as a new idea, they come alive in the person of Christ. You see the whole thing defined in him, where we've defined it in various ideas, various theologies, various Bible doctrines, and all of that. You see it as it in its direct reference to him, with the realization he's in me. And that's the whole point, see? We're not talking about a Christ that's not in you. We're talking about our salvation here. We're talking about the one that is in you. And the thing that I had already gotten into a study on, the measuring of the house. The measuring of the house. The measuring of the house. The Son of Man measuring the house. The Son of Man coming to be fulfilled in Christ himself, but also it is Ezekiel there who's called the Son of Man, and Ezekiel is a prophet. That's what caught my attention, because I've been wrestling with that anyway. I've gone through the whole book of Ezekiel and was pretty well into the 40th chapters and staying there, and on the measuring of the house. And I may have been along that line last time I was here in the later part of last year. So things go a long way. I stay on something a long time, generally, because it just keeps growing and keeps gathering in it to itself so much. So there it was. I thought, okay. I knew that Ezekiel was a prophet. I knew that he was, in fact, a type and shadow of the Son of Man. But I never put the two together. I never put the two together in the person of Christ. I had frankly never even, now hon, this is just a confession, I never even thought of Christ as prophet. Never. And in fact, you know that there are several religions that will agree that he was a prophet. I'm not talking about that he was a prophet. I'm talking about the prophet of God in the most extreme definition of the term prophet and prophecy, in the most extreme definition. That's what I'm talking about. And that's what this began to come into. And so I went back to the book of Ezekiel again, and then several other places, and then back into the New Testament. And every time I turned around, there it was. And then, like it always does with the Lord, then it just filled my soul. And I saw my prophet. Just like my high priest, just like my king, just like my life, I saw my prophet. Now, I've been talking about that on the monthly CDs, but those are, you know, those come and they're over with, and as much as can be said, but not everything can be said. So I want to talk with you about that, because it's where I still very much am, and it'll probably occupy a number of CDs. The one coming out this month has to do with the standard of God and the one who stands in the midst. And that all identifies with Christ the prophet. Who is that? It's the Son of God. But who's the high priest? It's the Son of God. Who's the king? It's the Son of God. Who's the Lamb? It's the Son of God. Where is he? He's in you.
Amen.
But hon, now I'm just going to be honest, just like with family here. It's like with family here. You can listen to the CDs, you know, sit down and listen to them. They're an hour long. But I want us to contemplate some stuff here. I want us to think about this. We sang the song a while ago, "Reveal Your Son in Me." That happens when we are shut away with the Lord. Mm-hmm. In our hearts. In our very souls. Before Him. In quietness. Amen. Oh, there can be a lot of stuff going on around you, but in your soul, it's quiet before the Lord. I want us to think about this. So I'm not interested in how much I cover, because, you know, I'll be still covering it for some time. And I appreciate the opportunity to share it with you on our monthly CDs. But every time I make one of those CDs, I cover about two pages in a notebook like this one right here. Because I just, you know, I write these notes to myself. Sometimes I have nothing here except questions to myself and references where I can go, and I have printouts. And that's just the way I do it. We were talking about when I began to come into this view of Christ. We were in Ezekiel, the 40th chapter. I want to read the first five verses there to you. And we'll start there. And we'll talk about this. We'll go a little bit on this tonight, and we'll come back with it again. Ezekiel, the 40th chapter. There's something here that we need not, that we must not look over, and that's the, and I want to make a point out of it. Ezekiel chapter 40. The prophet's vision of the temple. See, I can't even read anything anymore without, I just say, that's Jesus. Listen, hon, we're going to find out. This, every prophet that was truly of God, that's why God was so hard on false prophets. And that's why you've read it in your Bible. It's not a good thing to be a false prophet. It's not a good thing.
It's scary.
See? And the Lord was so hard. Why? Because every true prophet of God is a direct type of Jesus Christ. And I never understood that. I knew I had a real problem with what has been in the church world, you know, and what we've done with a lot of things, and what we've done with apostleship, and what we've done with shepherdship, and what we've done with prophecy, and what we've done with, of course, that goes with speaking in tongues, and I speak in tongues every day. But what we end up doing with it, it becomes centered back here in me or in you or in somebody time and time and time again. Well, I'm not even out trying to get on a soapbox and criticize that. I just know that that's not the best view. That view comes short of Christ Himself. And I've always known that, but just said, okay, leave it alone. And I've been talked to about it by some of the best. I mean some of the best. And I just have to kind of leave it alone. And I'm still, you know, I'm not trying to make issues out of anything, but I've had the questions. I have had the questions concerning these prophets and the ministry that they represented, because they represented a ministry. But they didn't, see, we think that they just represented a ministry that was to come. But they represented more than a ministry that was to come. They represented a prophet that was to come. Mm-hmm. And there's the whole point. There's the whole point, see. They represented a prophet that was to come. Mm-hmm. Who would not speak about the things of God, even in truth. he would speak as God in the ultimate definition of truth, saying, I am the truth. Not just what I say is truth. You can hear what I say, he said to his disciples, and still not understand it. In fact, you hear me every day, and I'm ad-libbing this, but you know, you hear me every day, and you still don't understand. You don't understand. But you will when the Spirit of truth has come. Now, that wasn't just the experience of Pentecost. That was the indwelling of Pentecost. Who is Pentecost? Who's Passover? Who's tabernacle? Pentecost is him too.
Right.
Dwelling in you. Amen. Dwelling in you. Pentecost is about the indwelling
right.
of the one who embodies the cross, who embodies Passover, right. his death, his burial, his resurrection. Now he dwells in you. Mm-hmm. Examine yourself. You see him. But where is he? He's in you. And the same thing. His burial. Oh yes, hon. The Lord is beginning to, I've been dealing with that on the Wednesday night teachings. And we're up now to the feast of Israel. We're up now to the feast of Pentecost, in fact, on the Wednesday night sessions. It's Christ, hon. It's Christ. I don't mean just Christ as a word, Christ as a religion. I mean as a person. And the whole point is, he's in you.
Amen.
Then where is the feast? In you. The prop. Are you a partaker? Are you, you know, are you a partaker of him in that realization, in that comprehension? Is that comprehension of him filling your soul? That is spoken of in those feasts. Well, back to the prophet. Personally, I have never comprehended Christ in that way. Never. I just never had. And it gathered so much up into itself. Now, Ezekiel. In the 25th year of our captivity. Now remember where this man is. He's in Babylon. He's in Babylonian captivity. Think about that. He's right there with the rest of the captives. In the beginning of the year, in the 10th day of the month, in the 14th year after the city was smitten, that's Jerusalem, in the selfsame day, the hand of the Lord was upon me and brought me thither. And in the visions of God brought me into the land of Israel and set me up on a very high mountain. This sounds like John in the book of Revelation. Well, that's because it's the same thing. Now, I'm not going to spend an hour on that. I think maybe I did on the CD. I don't know. But I'm not going to do that. Or we would be turning now to, in fact, I have it in this Bible right here, I believe. Let me see, it's not there. Must be right there. Yeah, Revelation, the first chapter, just in case we decided to turn there. But read the first chapter. Read the first chapter. Here is the fulfillment of what Ezekiel is seeing there. On everybody, not everybody, but so many, and all their bird dogs are waiting for something, waiting for the book of Revelation to be fulfilled. It's already fulfilled in the person of Christ.
Amen.
The point is, we try to understand it from from two ways. We try to understand it from the standpoint, all of our natural, with our natural mind, with our own mind, we try to understand it from the standpoint of world events, yet to come or not to come, or worse yet, we spiritualize it away. We spiritualize it. We spiritualize it. And we make it man, and we make it focus upon ourselves. And I personally don't have the time, if I was here with you for 3 weeks, to really even give examples of that. Because every kind of a movement that you can imagine, from some of the older sonship movements to some of the latter rain movements to some of the kingdom movements, come out of those interpretations. And they're all flesh-centered. They're all man-centered. Hun, how can a book called The Revelation of Jesus Christ be anything but Christ-centered? You know. So we're here in Ezekiel. And he's seeing the same man. But here he is seeing him before the fulfillment. John is seeing him as the fulfillment. Same man. And that's my point right here in verse 3. And he brought me thither, and behold, there was a man. In fact, in the Hebrew scripture, it just says, and behold, a man. And behold, a man. I've just been weeks and months, because it's just a thrill. I mean, see, this is what God does. This is what the true voice of the prophet does. It doesn't show you a thing. It doesn't show you a teaching. It doesn't show you a place. Oh, there were words given to him. He was taken to a place, and he saw a thing. But all of it was centered in, defined, and measured by a man. And the whole book of Revelation starts off the same way. A man. Only there it is, the Son of Man, whom we know to be the Son of God. And certainly after John gets through describing it. But this man's the same way. Same way. He's the same when he started that description of this man in the first chapter, what is called in our Bible, the first chapter of Ezekiel, but just way back at the beginning of this prophecy. This same man. This same man. No need to try to figure out who the four living ones are. They're just that fourfold view, that four square view of the man. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Now here's the man. And so here's where it got me right here. And behold, a man whose appearance was like the appearance of brass. The line of flax was in his hand. I remember we talked about the man on the CD, the man with the line in his hand. Hallelujah. And a measuring reed, and he stood in the gate. Hallelujah to God. Well, you see, this man came to do some measuring. And he still does. Only now in the reality of the thing. We've talked about that. But my attention then was focused upon the man. And I started these notes. We must first consider the man. For he and he alone can measure the house. Why? He is the foundation of it. He is the cornerstone of it. He is the headstone, the head of the corner of it. He is the fullness that filleth it. Only he can measure the house unto full stature. And so what does Paul say? Till we all come in the unity of the faith, and he's referring there in the Greek to the faith of the Son of God. Every time it's called the faith, it is referring to the faith of the Son of God. Now, I'm just telling you the fact of that. Till we come where? In our gatherings, in our doings, in our living, but most particularly in our gatherings, till we come in, until it is something we do in the faith of the Son of God, which is, it goes on to say, even, in other words, the knowledge of the Son of God. Till we all come in the unity of the knowledge of the Son of God. To what measure a perfect man? It's not talking about me or you. The perfect man is to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Hallelujah. So it's the man that we're talking about. But in between that, in between that lesson or that reality and the next time I began to share anything, there was this dealing of the Lord concerning this man. And so I continued to write in these notes. In order to consider this man in the scripture before the Lord, that we may come to know him, we not come to see him as Ezekiel did, but that we come to see him as John did. That we come to see him in an inward way, as Paul did. And that we come to the point that we understand that if we know something, spiritually know something, that we must know it by him. We must know it through understanding that he, in fact, is the fulfillment of it. That he, in fact, is the fulfillment of it. That we know it by him. Not know it as a thing in and of itself that we want God to do for us, that we know it in the person of the indwelling Son. That we know it by him. We must now consider Christ, the Son of God, as the Son of Man. And to do that, we must consider the threefold revealing of Christ as prophet, priest, and king. The order of the measuring. I want us to notice the order in which we must approach the house being measured, the measuring of the house. The house is the object. It's that that's being measured. That's you and me. But it is not about the house. And it's not to make the house in and of itself better. It is to show the house its betterness. Let me put it another way. It's not to make the house in and of itself righteous. It is to show the house its righteousness in the person of Jesus Christ. So the house is the object, huh? You and I are certainly the object of our salvation. It's just that Christ is central to our salvation in that He is our salvation. It's not something, beloved, that He has given to me or given to you. It's who He Himself is. It would be far less if it was something He had given us. It would be far less if it was something He had done for us, merely in that way. No, it's who He is in us. Now, if we want to say, He did that for me, say it. I don't care. But in most instances, we think salvation is something He did for us other than His very person. No, it's who He is. Then don't you and I then, if what I've just said is true and what we have just agreed with and we've heard before is true, then doesn't it just make spiritual sense that if that is true, if He is central, if the man is central, and you know, read the verses, hon, my God, He's central all the way through it. And particularly it's noted here in Ezekiel, and it's certainly noted in the book of Revelation. Who starts out? Who starts out? I am Alpha, I am Omega. Who ends up sitting on the throne? The light of the city of God. Amen. Out from whom is realized the river of life. Mm-hmm. Who is that? Right. Who is the depth of it, the height of it, the length of it, the square of it, of the city of God? It is Him. Amen. The measure of it, it is Him. Is it Ezekiel? Yes, it is. It talks about the river. And you've heard sermons preached on that. We talk about ankle deep and knee deep, and some preacher will tell you what that is and what that experience is and how. Oh, honey, come on. I've heard so many sermons preached on it, and people shout, jump up, run. Pretty soon, you know, they're going to get to swimming in it, and they make that the measure of their own experiences. Baby darling, He is the river, and He is the measure of the river. We might be only ankle deep in our comprehending of Him, but that's not the measure of the river. Or knee deep, or thigh deep, or waist deep, or even swimming around in it. It has no bottom to it. He is the measure of the river. Ezekiel saw it here. John saw it coming out of the throne of God. The street of it. The street of it. It's the river of life. Honey, it's Christ in you. If these things be true, and they are true, But if they're true in our hearts, and doesn't it just make spiritual sense that knowing Him is what our salvation is all about? Growing up into Him. Mm-hmm. Being filled. Not with knowledge about Him. Being filled with Him as the knowledge of the Lord. Now, this is where the prophet will come in. I'm just talking to you right now. Being filled with Him who is the knowledge of the Lord. Come on, honey. He is the brightness. He is the brightness, the shining and the brightness of God. How does it say that? How does it say that? I've got it written down in somewhere, but I can turn to it right here in Hebrews. How does chapter... who being the brightness of His glory. And that's right after saying that the Father hath spoken in the Son. Who being the brightness. Now the word His has been added there. It is in reference to God, but it just reads actually, who being the brightness of glory. And the express image of His person. And upholding all things by the word of His power. Not by the power of His word, by the word of His power. By the word of His power. God upholding all things by the word, which is Christ, the word of His power. All right, you'll get a hold of that. When He had by Himself purged our sins, set down the right hand of the Majesty on high. And it goes on. The house is being measured. It's the object of the measuring. But central to the house and to the measure of the house is the one who is the full measure of it. So in these little times that we're going to have together for just considering. So you're going to have to think about this tonight. And talk about it one with another. If you've got a question, write it down. Write it down. Bring it with you. If there's something we need to talk about, write it down. Bring it with you tomorrow. I'm serious about that. I'm serious about that. Our full thought just now must be on the man. Ezekiel's focus was totally upon the man. He brought me thither, and behold, there was a man. And everything after that was what the man showed to him. Mm-hmm. What the man said to him. What the man, all the way through, his focus was on the man. And even when he comes to the point and says, now, you show the house to the house. Darling, the proper translation of that and the thought of that in the Hebrewic meaning of that verse is show the fullness of the house to the house. Hun, that's the man. Mm-hmm. That's the man. It's not show me to me. It's not show you, it's not show us to us, but show us the man. Why? It's His body that we are. We're nobody's body but His. I've got a body. And that was part of my peace in this incident that is past. But the body that I am is the body that He is. Or let me put it this way. The body that we are is the body that He is. We are His body. But you take away the one, and the whole thing is null and void. The whole thing is just null and void. I don't care how many doctrines we've got built around it. You take Him out of it, it's just null and void. That's why, to me, it is so futile for Christians in almost every generation to come up with a new format of gathering together. Now, I'm not saying some of these formats are not good. I guess I've gone through a few formats myself. It seems like if you're not very careful, you end up focusing more on the format. And then you end up saying, this is the way we do it, and this is what has to be done, and we're doing it this way because we're righteous and holy and good, and we wish you had done it the same way because you're not righteous, holy, or good. You know, I mean, I know I'm making kind of fun of it, but we get all caught up. And it's not even our body, it's His. And we think we can come up with all of these formats. Well, see, it really doesn't make any difference. It doesn't make any difference whether we're gathered in this part of this facilities tonight or some other part of it, or if we're sitting outside under a tree as far as formats are concerned, it's still His body. I don't mind changing formats if they facilitate ministry in a better way, so we change the format to facilitate what the Lord is doing and saying in our hearts at that time. I don't mind that. But you got to be really careful because people tend to just get bogged down in formats. Okay? And I'm finding that the format that facilitated the inward working of the knowledge of the Lord at one time may not continue to facilitate that. There may need to be a different format. You understand what I mean by the word format? Arrangement of things. Rather than just saying, well, we've been doing it this way for 5 years now, and we have to do it this way, or 50 years or whatever, and we have to continue to do it this way. Well, I'm pretty old-fashioned, and I'm ultra-conservative, I'll tell you that now, and I do not like change. But I'm finding that one format after another just falls because it no longer facilitates a working comprehension of the Lord Jesus. And that is the comprehension that is supposed to be in His body. Why? Again, darling, because we are His body. I know we gather as His body. And therefore, we should gather together in a working, ongoing knowledge of Him. And whatever enables us to share that with one another the best, that's the way we ought to do it. Whatever enables us to fellowship in that understanding, that's the way we ought to do it. And let the Lord direct in that. You understand what I'm saying? And we're not going to worry about it. We're not going to burn our buildings down. I don't like to sit out in the rain any more than you do. I'm talking about just formats that become real religion with a lot of folks, and have over the time. So much you say, well, we didn't do this, we didn't do that, and I don't like that, so I'm going to find a place where they do this and where they do that. Well, okay. I mean, if that's what you're looking for, rather than the knowing of the Lord, it don't one place just good as another anyway.
Right.
Well, all right, that's the reason I'm saying I wasn't going to hurry on this, because I'm not able to do this on a CD, but I'm telling you that the one who is the measure of the house is the one upon whom the house must come to be focused. Now, he's the prophet. See, that's the whole point. You begin, and that's what I begin to see here. The connection between Ezekiel, the prophet, and Ezekiel, the son of man, which is a type of Christ, is that it's both are fulfilled in Christ himself. Both are fulfilled. He is the Son of Man, he said. I am the Son of Man. And he is also the prophet. John said, after the death, burial, resurrection, I looked and I saw one like unto the Son of Man. Who is that? It's the indwelling Son of God, but the Son of Man fulfills the office of the prophet. Of the prophet. Now we're going to get into that. I'm going to show you that. We're going to see that in the scripture. Because we're going to see the heart of the prophet. And I want to read you some verses. See, I brought my watch so I don't have to ask you what time it is. But we started at 6 and I'm 20 minutes till 8. And I'm not going to go over 2. Because we're coming back tomorrow.
I said, here I brought my watch just to tell you what time it is.
Well, I'll just ask you and I won't have to look at mine. Deuteronomy. I want us to look at the nature and the office of the prophet. Where do we see these things? We see it here in the scripture. We look at the true prophets of God. But every one of them had a different characteristic. Every one of them. But there's one thing, and we'll come to look at that. Actually, there's 3 things, but those 3 things are rolled up into one. At least they're rolled up and fulfilled in Christ, that every one of these prophets had in common. And we'll start to look at that in the morning. Every single one of them. Therefore, every one of these prophets, and some other verses we'll look at, set forth a type and a shadow of the prophet that was to come. Uh-huh. And he's here in Deuteronomy 18. Uh-huh. The Lord thy God. This was after they said, cover up your face and don't talk to us anymore. We can't see any more of this. We can't listen to any more of it, lest we die. God's answer to that was, all right, Moses will put a veil on his face. But I will raise up a prophet. You will either hear or you will die. The Lord thy God, this was Moses answering them. Moses who? Moses the prophet. The Lord thy God will raise up unto thee a prophet from the midst of thee, of thy brethren, like unto me. Unto him ye shall hearken. Now you know that Peter says the same thing in Acts. according to all that thou desirest of the Lord thy God in Horeb, which is when they made their statements, in the day of the assembly, saying, let me not hear again the voice of the Lord my God, neither let me see this great fire any more, that I die not. And the Lord said unto me, they have well spoken that which they have spoken. Because the Lord goes on to say, they're hard-hearted, they're disobedient. During that very time, they built them a golden calf. I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren like unto thee. And I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak unto them all that I shall command him. And it shall come to pass that whosoever will not hearken to my words, which he shall speak in my name, I will require it of him. But you see, this is not another man. Not in that way. And we're going to look at that. We're going to get into that. Oh yes, he walked for 3.5 years. And he testified of them, I do not come in my own name. He testified in their midst, I'm not coming. If I come in my name, you would receive me. Right. I come in the name of another and you call me a blasphemer. Mm-hmm. You hear my sayings, you do not understand them because my word is not in you. Right. Over and over and over and over again. He never denied he was the prophet. He just told him, you cannot hear me. You cannot hear me. You would not hear the prophets that were before me, and you won't hear me. And it was required of them. He came into his own, and his own received him not, but to as many as received him. You see, hon, it never hit me. Man, it hit me back some little time ago. My God, it's the prophet they didn't receive. Mm-hmm. And it broke my heart. It broke my heart because that's in the church today. Oh, yeah, they had received him as the high priest. They had received him as king. Not as the prophet. They reject him. They rejected what he said because they rejected who he was. And I see that in the church world today. It's the prophet they've missed. It's the prophet that they have missed. The prophet who does not speak on behalf of God, the prophet who speaks as God. My Father and I are one. He blasphemes. He calls himself God. No other man could do that except God just strike him off the face of the earth. Of course, I say that, and then I know that there's many teachings going on today that says, we are God. I am God. Dawned on me. Acts 3:22 is where this is repeated. For Moses truly said unto the fathers, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren like unto me. Him shall you hear in all things whatsoever he shall say unto you. And it shall come to pass that every soul, and that's the Hebrew meaning of the of what I've just read in Deuteronomy, that every soul which will not hear that prophet, my God. See, that's where it hit me, because I know that, see, everything he was saying in that 3.5 years was pointing toward trying to bring Israel to him, and they would not come. The cross would have been there anyway. It's just that they wouldn't receive him in the cross. His desire was to live in them, not just talk to them. Don't forget, his disciples were Jews, and everybody around him was Jews. Don't forget that on the day of Pentecost, they were all Jews, even though they came out of every nation on the face of the earth. That's the way it is, every nation. But, hun, the Greek meaning of that, pointing back to the Hebrew meaning of that, was wherever Israel was scattered and they were gathered out of those places, they even spoke different languages, which was why they all heard them speak in tongues, and they heard in their own language the gospel preached to them. They actually heard what Joel said and the fulfillment of it preached to them. You understand what I'm saying to you here? Because his intention was not for them to simply hear his words. There was more coming if they would have obeyed his words. He would be the living word in them. He would not simply be a prophet to them. He would be the very prophet of God living in them. And he would speak to them the living word of God, which would save their souls and transform their very souls. That's where he speaks now. And there's so many who would like to keep him outside and just read his words and say, well, I believe what I'm reading. But have you heard him who says it? The prophet moves inwardly. He is the prophet in us. But he's not there speaking words. He is there as the word that God hath spoken. Have you heard him? Now, if you haven't, there's no condemnation over that. It's just that we need to turn and say, Father, I want to hear his voice. I want to see his face. You have spoken in the Son. Father God, reveal that Son in me.
Amen.
That's the prophet I want to hear. That's the prophet I want to hear. I can hear, and I'll use myself as an example rather than anybody else. I can hear Brother Lumen say things about him, preach about him, say true things about him. Father, I want to hear him.
Amen.
I want to hear the perfect word. I want to see the perfect man. I want to know him.
Amen. Amen.
And darling, that won't hurt my feelings, because I'm only here for one reason, and that's that we see him.
Amen.
Otherwise, I would be better off staying at home and not going anywhere in the body of Christ. Just stay at home. Do them all a favor and just stay at home. They're confused enough already. Man-centered enough already. They don't need your help, Mr. Ruman, on that. And I feel that way. And I thank the Lord for it. You're not designed of God in Christ just for the hearing of me or for the hearing of one another.
No,
but for the hearing of Him.
Amen.
Which we do share with one another, but we do that that we may bring one another to turn and see Him and create an environment for knowing Him. He's that prophet that the scripture is talking about. And that it's Peter that stands up and says this, of course, there early on in the recording of the book of Acts. Acts 7:37. This is Moses, which said to the children of Israel, this is, if I'm not mistaken, Stephen. You know what happened to him? I mean, when he said this. And it eventually, years later on, happened to Peter too, although they just hung him upside down. They stoned Stephen. And that's when the Lord put a hook in Paul. Right there. During the stoning of Stephen. That's probably the first genuine witness of the truth and an open heaven to Paul ever heard anything about. Right there. When Stephen was stoned and Paul was holding their coats. Yeah, I believe that to be true. This is that he said, a prophet shall the Lord your God rise up unto you of your brethren like unto me. Him shall you hear. Now what that means, that the actual meaning of that, him shall you hear, it doesn't mean you're all just going to hear it. Him you shall hear or you shall not. Him you shall hear or you shall reap the recompense. Him you shall hear for the salvation of your soul. And that's what that is talking about. That's the how that ought to be and is actually translated. And then in Luke 24:19, we'll look at this just briefly in a comment probably tomorrow. In Luke 24:19, and they said to him, and he said to them, what things? That's when he's walking along with these two guys, these two disciples of his, going to Emmaus. What things? And they said to him, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, which was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all of the people. They didn't know how mighty. They didn't know he revealed himself to them to be the prophet. He opened their eyes in the prophets and their hearts burned within them. He was giving them a witness and a testimony of that which would take place not many days hence. In fact, 50 days hence at the Feast of Pentecost. And he opened their eyes when he broke bread. And they knew. Can you imagine? And they knew who he was. They may well have seen him killed. And yet, they knew who he was. And then he vanished. Hallelujah. See, he never let them or his disciples cling to his earthly appearance. For 40 days he was with them for their comfort and for their teaching. And then the earthly appearance disappeared before their eyes, that he may come again in another form and be in you. The living prophet, the living word of God. We want to look at that. I'm going to stop there tonight. And there's a lot here that we won't cover, but there's some things that haven't been covered that we will. I want us to consider these things. And honey, the only reason I want us to consider these things is that you and me, I remember when this, I remember when the Lord began to deal with me about this view. I remember. Father God, I don't want to just see that he is the prophet and begin to preach. Let, oh Father, let me know him as the true prophet of God. Amen. And when he speaks, my soul obeys. That the vision he brings forth is of himself, fulfilled in himself. Blessed be the name of the Lord Jesus. Folks, do we realize the greatness of that? I know you and I have heard some good preachers, maybe even great preachers or whatever. But there's nothing like hearing him. I don't mean hearing him say words, because inwardly he doesn't say words. He shows himself to you as the Word. There's a difference. You say, can you explain that? Well, no, I can say it, and I can come at it from about 10 or 12 different directions, but I really can't. But what I tell you is the truth. He shows himself. And in him you see the thought of the Father. I mean, the thought comes into your heart. The intention comes into your soul. It's a communication of God with your soul, not with your eardrum anyway. Now, I fully believe that if we're not obedient to what he communicates to us in our eardrums, that we're never going to have to worry about the eternal word, because we're never going to hear him anyway. Now, we may have to worry about him, but you don't understand what I'm saying? But we're not going to hear it. We can be like Israel. We can't hear. We can't hear anymore. We don't want to hear anymore. Get rid of that. We can't stand that voice. And that was a type and shadow. Cover up your face. We can't stand that glory. That was a type and shadow. Who is the brightness of the glory? He's in you. Oh, hon, to see him is the only true life-changing, life-transforming, soul-transforming experience.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And it is an ongoing and a never-ending reality. And it's not to be condemned in hearing me or in these emails we've been getting. They've been we want what we are, have been hearing. We want to see him. That we may, and see, that's not, not to, we're not condemned in that. Father, reveal your Son. And that's the good pleasure of the Father do, and he will do it to a heart that is turned. And he will communicate to you through his prophet, through his eternal word. No other prophet given of God has been able to speak that word, and none can. But he's the one that everyone has come testifying of.